So good morning students. So now we'll be learning about the memory management techniques. So here mainly we'll be seeing about some of technical concepts. Okay, so what is involved in the memory management technique. So we'll be seeing what is your swapping technique. So we'll see about the contiguous memory location. Okay, and paging, so which is a memory management technique. Okay, and we'll see the structure of page table, which is involved in the paging, and then segmentation, another memory management technique. And we'll just see some of examples of examples where we are going to use paging as well as a segmentation technique. Okay, the main objective of this one is, okay, so here we are going to see the different ways in which the how the memory is organized. Okay, so how the memory hardware is used to organize or store the contents. Okay, in the memory location. So we'll discuss the various memory management techniques. Okay, so mainly about your paging and segmentation. So now here, okay, we know that, okay, the basic background is, okay, so we know whenever we execute, we are bringing a program, okay, so from the main memory, okay, from the disk, okay, and then that we are getting into the main memory, and it is placed at a particular location in the main memory for the purpose of run, okay. So now main memory and registers are the only storage devices that your CPU can access. Okay, and register contents are accessed by CPU in one clock cycle. Okay, so it is accessed in one clock cycle. Okay, so whereas main memory contents, okay, whatever you store, okay, whenever the CPU is executing, if it is needing any data or instruction, okay, it need to be brought from the main memory to your CPU. So that is accessed using the mini cycle. Okay, so because the register is part of your CPU, so it is accessing the content from the register is done only in one CPU cycle. So in main memory, okay, it is taking mini cycle. Okay, so normally cache is sitting between the main memory and the CPU register. Okay, so frequently accessed contents, whatever we need. Okay, so that is always stored in the cache. Okay, so now protection of the memory is always required to perform the correct operation. Okay, so now here let's see what are the different things which are involved in the main memory. Okay, so now we have a pair of registers. Okay, so now this is where the memory is divided. Okay, you can see the memory is divided, okay, between two portions. So one portion is kept for the operating system and the rest of the portion is kept for the user process. Okay, so now each process will have a bound. Okay, so that process is always protected using the different set of registers. Okay, so process is beginning here and process ending here. Okay, now base register is going to define, okay, the value where the first instruction of that particular process is going to be stored. Okay, and limit register is going to define what is the size of your process. Okay, so if your base register value is the address of this first instruction of this process, if it is 3,40,000, okay, then if limit is defining as 1,20,000 something, okay, so this 3,40,000 and 1,20,000 something. Okay, so the final address will be, okay, base address plus this limit. So this will be your final address. Okay, so we always require, okay, so this address, okay, base and limit register, which is providing, which is helping us to protect this process from accessing the instruction from the other process. So like this, we'll be having a base and this one. So like that, see, there is one more process which is allocated to this portion. There is one more process which is allocated to this particular portion. So now here, address binding of instruction and data to memory address can happen at three different stages. Okay, so now first let us know what is your binding. Okay, so binding is a term. Okay, so like you can imagine, okay, there is two piece of cloth, okay, and we are using a particular thread and stitching it. Okay, so now that particular thread is actually binding the two piece of cloth. Okay, so like that, binding is in a sense that you are binding the code or the instruction to the memory. So what is actually binding is your address. Okay, so two piece of cloth is binded by using a thread. So similar way here, the address is binding the instruction okay, that is your code or your data to the memory. Okay, so now this binding can happen at three different stages. Okay, so one is called as a compile time. Okay, so if you are knowing a memory location before execution, that is before prior to that, okay, then the address of that particular code or your data can be binded at the compile time. Okay, so if it can be done, so then you'll be able to generate the absolute code. If the address is going to change, okay, if it is not going to fix it, then no absolute code can be generated. Your code has to be relocated. Okay, relocated in a sense, like see here, whenever we are constructing a house, anybody is asking the address of your house, always you can say that this is my address of the house. Okay, so that is permanently there. Okay, now that your house is not relocatable. Okay, suppose if someone is constructing their house, okay, on a van, okay, that will be a mobile house. Okay, anywhere it can change. Okay, so it is relocating itself from one place to the other place. Okay, so you must have seen some such a houses, okay, which is having a comfort and even can travel. So those houses are relocatable. So that means that the address keep on changing. Okay, so if it is fixed and always that is going to reside, always loaded into the same memory, so that time we are calling, if it is always fixed, it is not getting changed, then we are saying it is not relocatable. Okay, so if it is changing, then we are saying it is relocatable. Okay, now if the address is known for you earlier itself, okay, so then we can bind the code, okay, bind your code to that particular address. So that kind of binding we are calling it as a compile time binding. So when compile time binding is there, then absolute code can be generated. So absolute code means this, we are talking about, okay, the transformation of your code. Okay, so now transformation of code, you are actually learning in the compiler design subject, where whenever we write instruction, so what happens is when you compile it, what happens, there will be several passes. First pass, it is going to replace your variables with the addresses. Okay, so compile time, whatever declaration variables you have done, so those variables will be replaced by address. Suppose if you are writing c is equal to a plus b. Okay, now this instruction will be replaced by the address of c is equal to address of a plus address of b. Okay, so it means that the content from that particular address will be added to the content which is stored at this particular address. Okay, so in the first pass, you are going to replace this variable by the address. Okay, so this kind of code we are calling it as a object code. Now this can be done only if you are knowing the address prior. Okay, another type of binding we are calling it as a load time binding. Okay, so load time binding. Okay, so where the address is not fixed. Okay, so for these variables, okay, for this kind of data, your address may be fixed. So load time binding, there may be some modules. Okay, so where you are not always loading into the same location, so those are the relocatable code. So this binding is always done not at the compile time, at the time of loading your models. Okay, like suppose if you are having hash include stdio.h, okay, so you are using some of our functions from that particular library, so those modules, okay, those functions will also be part of your program. Okay, you are using a square root, so square root function is also a part of a program. So square root is a function what you are calling, so that is available in math library, so that you are actually binding, that model is also included at the load time. So that kind of binding you are calling it as a load time binding. Okay, and second type of binding you are calling it as a execution time. Okay, so this will be for your dynamic variables, so wherever we are not having the dynamic memory allocation like malloc, calloc and all, so that time the memory is declared at the runtime. So that kind of binding for those variable is called as a execution time binding. Okay, so we are having compile time, load time and execution time binding. Okay, so now here this is generally showing you the step of process. Okay, a user program is always undergoing. So first we'll be having your source program, so after that you compile that, either you compile or assemble it, so this is called as a compile time. Okay, after that a object model is created. Okay, and that is linked with a linkage editor, so here we are going to have other object model. Okay, other object model in a sense, suppose see I can write my program. or you are writing your program. So in your program, okay, you can include, if I'm writing a program and then I'm instead of writing saving it as d.c, I'll be saving it as a d.h. okay, then if you write hash include, okay, instead of writing the angular bracket, if you're writing, okay, so instead of writing the angular bracket, okay, if you're writing this fashion, okay, instead of writing with the angular bracket, okay, I have to write in double quotes, okay, so d.h, okay, so I just include how you include hash include stdio.h with angular bracket. I write some function and save it as d.h. I said hash include, okay, quotation d.h. So this is whatever I write in d.h, so that will be added on, linked with your module. So that is done at the linkage editor, okay, and then including this, so you are loading the modules. So this is called as load time, so that is given to your loader. And here system library, system library instance, if you are using any like mat.h square root function you are going to use, okay, so like that sine, cos, any of a library functions you are going to use from the library, so this will be again given access to the loader. So that code will be given access to the loader along with the object module, whatever is created by you, okay. And then so after the loader, so dynamic loaded system library in essence, if you are using malloc, calloc dynamic functions at the runtime, so that is linked at this stage. So now this is your final binary memory image, so that is in the form of zeros and ones. So that is an image which is created, which will be actually is a correct form of execution, so which is ready, where we can give it for ready for execution. So now this way your program is undergoing a different stages, okay, from taking use of compiler, okay, linkage editor, loader and so on, okay. So now let's see what is your logical address and what is your physical address, okay. So the concept of logical address space, okay, that is bound to a separate physical address space, it's very important for us, okay. So logical address is the address generated by the CPU, also referred to as a virtual address, okay. So physical address is the address actually seen by the memory unit, okay. So logical address space is generated by the, suppose if I'm having instruction, okay, so one, so likewise I have instruction 2, okay, instruction 3 and instruction 4, okay. So this is a logical view, the user is viewing his address in this sense, okay, we have instruction 1, okay, instruction 2 and so on, so user is viewing it as a 0, 1, 2 and 3, okay, so this is the address seen by your CPU, okay, and even the user's view of this address is also like that, okay. I may imagine that my instruction 1 is stored at the address 0, instruction 2 is stored at the address 1 and 3 is stored at the address 2 and 4 is stored at the address 3. So this is address actually seen by your CPU, and even this is a view of your normal user. So this is called as a virtual address or the logical address. So why we are calling it as a virtual address, because it is not actually existing, so you will have a different addresses existing in the main memory, so which you are calling it as a physical address, so that is actually seen by the memory unit, okay. So this is seen by the CPU or by the user, but this is a virtual address because it is not actually existing, okay, but your actual thing will be your physical address, okay. So actually what happens, we'll have a memory hardware which will transform your logical address to your physical address, okay. So logical and physical address are the same in compile time, okay, and load time, address binding, okay, but it is actually different in the execution time binding, okay. So here, so the it is varying in this particular fashion. So now we have a memory unit hardware, okay, which is actually mapping your logical address to your physical address. So hardware devices that map, okay, virtual to your physical address is always there. So in memory management unit scheme, okay, the value of the relocatable registers added to every address generated by the user process at the time it is sent to the memory. Okay, so that means the logical address is not the actual address. For that, you are adding the value of your relocatable register, and then that is actually the physical address generated. Okay, so the user program, we are weaving it with a logical address. Okay, but user is not bothered about to see the physical address. Okay, so that we can see in the next diagram here. Okay, so here the CPU is seeing the logical address. Okay, so he may be having instructions, some 500 instruction. Okay, now in the 500 instruction, right now you think that, okay, it is accessing the here we are going to access here it is going to access the instruction 346 instruction it is going to access. That is a logical address. So because it is a 346th instruction, okay, so we have started from 0 to 346. So this will be added to relocation register. So that relocation register will have an address of 14,000. Okay, and then this 14,000 plus 346, okay, is physical address 14,346. Okay, so that is actually your memory content. Okay, so if you want to access a 400 instruction, so we are adding 14,000 plus 400. Okay, so why 14,000? So why 40,000? What is a relocation register? So relocation register means here, because we know that, okay, we have seen in the memory. Okay, so one process executes, finishes off, leave it off. Okay, that space can be utilized by the new process. Okay, so now by having a relocatable register, so wherever we want, we can load a program. Okay, if I'm putting the in the relocation register 14,000, that means my first instruction of my program will start at this particular address. Okay, and then till where it goes, till the value of your limit register, till your length of your program is there. Okay, so now next time when I run my same program, I want my process to be loaded at the different address. So that means I want it to be relocated at the different address. So then I just need to change the value in the here. Instead of writing 14,000, if 20,000 is there, my first instruction of my process will be started at 20,000. Okay, so like by changing the value, by changing the address in the relocation register, so we are changing the location of program from one location to the other location. That is actually called as a relocation. Okay, so we always don't load our program into the same location, because there is lots of programs which are there in a system. Anywhere we want, we are loading it. So that will be decided at the runtime. Okay, so we, for that purpose, so we will just view a process with the logical address. Okay, so relocation register will help us to relocate the code or load a program, okay, wherever required, okay, by the operating system at the runtime. Okay, so it will see where the memory is free, there it will load, okay, by checking out the address. So if it is 14,000, first instruction of your process will start at 14,000. Okay, if this value is 25,000, first instruction of your process will be starting at the 25,000. So like that, whatever value is there in this relocation register at that particular instruction address only, your process will be, that will be the address of your first instruction of your process where it is getting loaded into the memory. So this is memory, so which is nothing but your main memory or the RAM, what we are talking about. Okay, so next we'll be seeing the dynamic binding. Okay, dynamic loading. Okay, so dynamic loading means routine is not loaded until it is called. Okay, so routine is not loaded until it is called. So that means, see here, we may be writing some of a functions, if you call a function. Okay, so that time of binding can be done at the compile time itself. Okay, because we have written the function code there itself. Okay, but dynamic loading means, so whenever you require, only then you are loading it. Okay, so whenever the routine is called, that means when you are executing it, okay, your module or your function will be loaded at that particular time. Okay, so the advantage of this is, okay, so you are having the better memory utilization. Okay, so unused routine, sometimes what happens, we may write so many routines. Okay, so all of them will not be used at the same time. Okay, so sometimes without requiring, I just include, because I know the header files name, I just include so many header files in my C program. Okay, but all of them are not needed at the same time. Okay, so what happens, okay, if we are not going for dynamic loading, then all of them will be connected together from the system library to the loader. Okay, so that is increasing the size of your program. okay, so size of your program is increased. Okay, so there lots of memory space is wasted because lot of time we may not be using some of our routines. Okay, so for that purpose dynamic loading is helping us. So the routine is loaded only when it is required. Okay, so that is going to save the memory space for us. Okay, so no special support from the operating system is required. Okay, implemented, it is just implemented using the program design. Okay, and dynamic linking. Okay, so dynamic linking also, so linking is of your code, like your modules is postponed until the execution time. Okay, so small piece of code called stub, okay, used to locate the appropriate memory resident library routine. Okay, so stub replaces itself with the address of the routine and executes the routine. Okay, see normal thing what happens. Okay, so whenever we write a function code, okay, so whatever values, like you must have learned about macros in C programming. Okay, so macros is nothing but, okay, if I'm writing hash define, okay, so if I write something like, okay, hash define, okay, hash define, okay, square sqa, okay, squ is x, okay, into, okay, x into x. So this is, I'm defining that. Okay, so wherever you have squ, it should replace that by a x into x. Okay, so square of, okay, which is nothing but sq, wherever you give it is be replaced by x into x. Okay, so square of x. So in this fashion we are going to write it. So this is a macro. Okay, so stub is also like a macro. Okay, so in this case for other functions and all what happens, so when you are compiling a program, so for the function call, okay, actually it is replacing by the function code. Okay, suppose if I'm writing some add function, okay, so that function code, how many times I have add function call in my coding, so wherever you have that add function call, there the code, it will be replaced, the function call will be replaced by the function code. Okay, now here in this case, okay, it is not doing that at a compile time. Okay, so at the runtime, it is replacing the itself with the this kind of your it is replacing with this kind of your statements. Okay, so this will be replacing with that particular address at the runtime. Okay, so operating system needs to check, okay, if routine is in the process memory address space. So like that, okay, so stubs are nothing but small piece of code, okay, which we are going to use for replacing like that. Okay, so dynamic linking is useful for libraries. So systems also known as a shared libraries. So next video we'll be talking about the